morning. Stand if you would. Let's sing Victory in Jesus. Baptist Church this morning. We are so glad to have you, and I've noticed a few new faces as everybody kind of gets back to normal. I see some people I haven't seen in a while. It's awesome and good to see you this morning. Sing the family of God. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed.
Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? Good. Glad that you're here. Glad that you've chosen to come and worship with us this morning. A few announcements this morning, and one I'm going to need some help with. I'm going to rely on Miss Carla. We have a shower, baby shower today for Tori and Caleb for little Sayla. Where and when? 3 o'clock this afternoon in the fellowship hall. All right, and so yeah, that is where that is located. Come be a part. Come bless them. Amber, it's great to see you today. A few more announcements. The promise at Glenrose. Deanna, do you have anything? So it's Texas. So it's Texas in a week. So prepare for 90-degree weather and prepare for 30-degree weather. So we are continuing youth services. All right, we have youth tonight at 6 o'clock, Jesus and basketball. We have Wednesday night services for both our youth and our children, as well as prayer meeting. Is there any more announcements, anything that we need to make mention of this morning? Yes, ma'am, Ms. Jill. You're good men. They can handle the truth, right? Okay. See, or if you are a man, all right, looking to join the prayer warriors, I know it's not the bear hunt, but if you're looking to join you have to be a member of the prayer. Okay, sign me up. All right. If you're a man looking to join the Prayer Warriors team, please see Miss Jill. Is there any more announcements? Yes, sir, Mr. Oh, okay. Happy birthday. I see that in a week, will it be Miss Annette's birthday too? Pretty close. Okay. All right. So 29 and 29, correct? Okay. All right. All right. Well, happy birthday to both of y'all. And so one late one. Is there any more announcements? Yes. Oof. Oof. Oh. Needs prayer. I've yet to meet the man who wins that battle, so praying for him. Yes. All right. Yes, sir. Nick. Go right ahead. Yes, Deanna, do you want to? Thank you. Do I need to say it? Reese's. Okay, good. All right. Bring extra then. I need a bag. All right. All right, is there any more prayer requests? Or prayer request announcements? Prayer requests either. All right, well, let's pray. Father, I thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for all the ways that you love us, all the ways that you bless us. Lord, Father, I pray today that we could be a blessing to you, Lord, that you would just meet with us. Father, I pray for chains of sin to be broken today, Lord. Father, I pray for lives to be renewed. Father, I lift up Mr. Baker to you. Father, I pray that after this run-in with this cow, Lord, that you would heal him of all his injuries, Lord, that he would bounce back even stronger, Lord. Father, I pray that you would just be glorified in the service today. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Something I'd like to say, just as blessed me, as I look out, I know as our elderly population is kind of staying away due to coronavirus and stuff, I look out and I see our pews filled with young families and young children. And God has really blessed us in that area. If that's all this church does is witness to your children and your grandchildren, that's an awesome responsibility. It's an awesome thing. Amen. Sing when we all get to heaven. Stand if you like. have the perfect music, we can have the perfect message, but without the Spirit of God, nothing will be done here. Is that not true? Correct, right? It's the Spirit of God that we long for. Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and now thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God. To see Jesus, to reach out and touch you and say that we love him. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch you.
I wanted to take this moment to let y'all know we're starting a Bible study in our Sunday school class. It starts at 10 on Sunday mornings, and it's Max Licato's Unshakable Hope. And if you've ever done anything with Max Licato, you know he's anointed by the Lord to really make things clear. And we felt like God brought this to us because it's based on the promises of God. And through 2020, you know, we need a strong foundation. If we don't have a strong foundation, we can build a house and it looks all good and pretty for a little while, but then it doesn't. So we're going to be talking about the promises of God, and we'd love to have you if you'd like to come. This song is called The God Who Stays, and you may have heard it on the radio. It's on the radio a lot right now, but it's just such a... My husband sent this to me this week, and he was just loving it, and I was loving it too, because it's not based on what we do. We are messed up people, right? We are some messed up people, and thank God his blood covers that. And so you just got to keep remembering these promises that God says. He's the God who stays. He's the one that will turn it around for you. And so I hope this ministers to you, and if it does, you can sing it over and over when you leave, I hope. If I were you, I would have given up on me by now. I would have labeled me a lost cause, 'cause I feel just like a lost cause. If I were you, I would have turned around and walked away. I would have labeled me beyond repair, 'cause I feel like I'm beyond repair. Oh, but somehow you don't see me like I do. Somehow you're still here. You're the God who stays. You're the God who stays. You're the one who runs in my direction. When the whole world walks away, you're the God who stands with wide open arms. And you tell me nothing I could ever do. Separate my heart from the God who stays. I used to hide every time I thought I let you down. I always thought I had to earn my way. But I'm learning you don't work that way. 'Cause somehow you don't see me like I do. Somehow you're still here. You're the God who stays. You're the God who stays. You're the one who runs in my direction. When the whole world walks away, you're the God who stands. Wide open arms, and you tell me nothing I have ever done. Separate my heart from the God who stays. My shame can't separate, my guilt can't separate, my past can't separate. I'm yours forever. My sin can't separate, and my scars can't separate, and my failures can't separate. I'm yours forever. No enemy can separate, no power of hell can take away. Your love for me will never change. I'm yours forever. 'Cause you're the God who stays. You're the God who stays. You're the one who runs in my direction. When the whole world walks away, you're the God who stands with wide open arms. And you tell me nothing I have ever done to separate my heart from the God who stays. You're the God who stays. You're the one who runs in my direction. When the whole world walks
Thornton. Separate my heart from the God who stays.
I know how Pharaoh felt as he saw him leave. Good morning. Turn in your Bibles, if you would, to Matthew chapter 21. Put yourself for a moment in the feet of Jesus. In chapter 21, we have the entrance into Jerusalem in the last few days of his life. Every evening, Jesus would walk back to Bethany. Every morning, he'd walk back to Jerusalem. He would confer with the Pharisees and the chief priests. He would teach in their courts. They disliked him more and more every day, and yet every morning he came back until they arrested him and crucified him. Every day he looked in the eyes of those who hated him and knew which ones would cry out for his death in just a few days. But he came back. He's a God who stays. Look with me, beginning in verses 33. Verse 33 of chapter 21 in Matthew. You can stand with me if you choose. It's a lengthy reading. You can be seated at any time you get tired. And the word proclaims, "Hear another parable. There was a certain householder which planted a vineyard and hedged it around about and digged a wine press in it and built a tower and let it out, rented it out to husbandmen and went into a far country. When the time of fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the husbandmen that they might receive the fruits of it. And the husbandmen took his servant and they beat one, they killed another, and they stoned another. Again, he sent other servants, more than the first, and they did unto him like them likewise. But last of all, he sent unto them his son, saying, they will reverence my son. But when the husbandmen saw the son, they said among themselves, this is the heir, let us kill him, and let us seize his inheritance. And they caught him, and they cast him out of the vineyard, and they slew him. When the Lord thereof the vineyard comes, what will he do with these husbandmen? And they said unto him, he will miserably destroy those wicked men and will let out his vineyard into other husbandmen, and they will render unto him his fruits in their season. Jesus said unto them, did you never read the scriptures? The stone which the builders reject, the same has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, say I unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to the nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof. And whosoever shall fall on this stone shall be broken, but on whomsoever it shall fall, it will grind him to powder. And the chief priests and Pharisees had heard this parable, and they perceived that he spoke of them. When they had sought to lay hands on him, they feared the multitude because they took him for a prophet. Bow with me for prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word today. And I pray today, Father, that your word might be made real and relevant to us. I pray for those that are here, Father, that have never received Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Father, I pray that your Spirit might show them, might enlighten their minds and show them their great need. I ask now that you guide us and direct us, and may Jesus be lifted up, and it's in his name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. The parable is an obvious allegory. Each character is represented by someone real, or a country that is real. As he was talking to them, the immediate meaning of the parable is very simple. Number one, the landowner refers to God. The vineyard represents the nation Israel. All Jews were familiar with the vineyard that's mentioned in Isaiah chapter 5 that God had planted, which symbolized Israel. The wicked tenants represent the Jewish religious leaders, the priests and the people. The servants sent by the owner represent the Old Testament prophets. God sent dozens of prophets to Israel to warn them of their sin, but the Jews mistreated the prophets and killed many of them. Of course, the owner's son represents Jesus Christ. The Bible says Christ came into his own and his own received him not in John chapter 1. The New Testament, the new tenants to whom the owner gave the vineyard represents you and I, the church. We tend to study parables from the perspective of man rather than the perspective of God. In the parable of the prodigal son, it's called the prodigal son, but really it's about a forgiving and loving father who's forgiving of the son. In this one today, it's called the parable of the tenants by most scripture, by most Bibles, but God's perspective is the parable of the patient and the loving landowner. In this story, Jesus teaches four fundamental truths about the character of God. And to fully appreciate God, we must uncover these truths and apply them to our lives. Number one, God is the owner of the vineyard. Like the owner in the parable, God owns everything. You and I own nothing. We come in this life and we think that we own something, and we get kind of proud sometimes. You might own your house, you may own some property, you think. But when you die, it all goes away. It goes back into the box. And if you don't pay your taxes on your house, come find out you're only renting it because the state takes it over. The county takes it over. We don't own anything. We're just here for a season. The tenants didn't own the vineyard, and the owner placed them expecting to receive some reward, some pay, and he went looking for grapes at the time of harvest, but he didn't get any. The tenants rejected the owner's request. I don't know if you have ever been in that situation where you've owned something or somebody has owed you some money, and they refused to pay it. Even though they have the ability to pay it, they refuse to, as if they don't own it. You didn't own it. It's kind of frustrating. In my particular case, I had sold a piece of equipment to a man for X amount of dollars, and he didn't pay. And my wife kept saying, "Where's the money? Where's the money? Where's the money?" Women keep up with those business deals, don't they? And he still refused to pay after a couple of years. And all the while, he and his wife took vacations and went to places they wanted to go and had a good time. And it built up in me a resentment towards that individual. And anyway, God had to show me. It was about 10 or 11 years later, he finally paid that bill. But God showed me in the meantime that we have to be forgiving just as God forgives us. We do the same thing to God that man does to me. Many times we take credit for owning things and rob God of the glory that is due him. You don't have a job, a good job, that God hadn't given you. You don't have the health and the ability to go to work that God hadn't given you. God gives us all of those things. Growing up in the South, many of you have heard the term sharecroppers. Now, you may not know what a sharecropper is. A sharecropper was an individual. My grandparents were one. They went and lived on a man's farm, and they worked the farm, planted the crops, harvested crops, and then when they harvested the crops, a portion went back to the landowner. They were just sharecroppers. They did all the work, but he owned the farm, and so they got a portion of the goods. This is the same thing. These people are sharecroppers on this God's property, and they don't want to share the goods when they take in the harvest. We laugh when a three-year-old child or grandchild grabs a toy and says, "Mine." We laugh, but know deep down we know it's sad because that child didn't earn that, didn't pay for it, didn't build it, but yet they think it's theirs. We do the same thing to God. We take possession of things that are His, that are rightfully His, and we claim them to be our own and without gratitude or thankfulness. I wonder how the Heavenly Father must feel when we walk into our house and say, "This is all mine." When we get into a nice new car and say, "Look what I've got, what I've bought." Or when we go online and check out our account balance and say, "Mine," and determine how we're going to spend every dime of it. Every good gift, everything that is of any value comes from God. Amen. God is the owner of all that you see and all that you possess. Everything that you see, everything that you know of, God is the creator of those things. God is patient. The owner of the vineyard sent messengers to collect what was doing, but the sharecroppers beat him up and kicked him out. The next one they killed, and the next one they stoned to death. If that was in modern day times, we'd be running to the police, filing the complaint. But if they didn't have that option in this parable. Today in America, we turn to the law to protect the rights of individuals. But what do we learn spiritually from this story? Is that we see that God is very patient. Can you imagine being a landowner, apartment owner, and people owing you money, you sending to collect the money, and they disrespecting the people you sent to them? Over and over again, these people disrespected the hand of God, and they weren't going to pay a dime. God sends, the lesson from this is God sends servants to communicate His will for your life. You live in a day and age where there is web access. You can get thousands of different sermons and Bible studies on the web. There's churches on every corner. There's preachers everywhere you look. They're a dime a dozen. Some of them are sorrier than others, but they're still a dime a dozen. You have access, and every one of them is bringing a message about your relationship with God. I want you to understand something. God's gone to great lengths, just as this old landowner went to great lengths. He sent many people to him in order for them to have the opportunity to do what was right. God has sent many communications to you and I in order that we could do what is right to Him, that we can give Him the honor and glory that is due Him. The parable is about each one of us. God has prepared a vineyard for us to manage. The great job you have is not gotten by your talent or your good looks. God puts you there. God has provided all the things that you have in this life. He's not asking you to give Him everything that you own, but He is asking you to give up your life and to give Him what He demands of you. God is not interested in our money. He does ask for 10%, but that 10% God doesn't need. I want you to understand that. He's wanting you to acknowledge the fact that He's worthy of your 10%, that He's worthy of your offering. He's worthy of your gifts. He wants you and He wants your heart. He wants your acts to acknowledge Him and His ownership and lordship over your life. God reaches out to you in love and And he has sent plenty of messengers to you in order to show you his love. God is so patient with you and I. If we've rejected him a dozen times, 100 times, or even 1,000 times, he just keeps sending messengers to deliver his word to you and I. In the early 19th century, before radio and television, and people were entertained by listening to public speakers and public orators, one of the most widely known at the time was a man by the name of Robert Ingersoll. He was a gifted speaker and an atheist. He traveled around the country delivering speeches of the foolishness of believing in God. He often concluded his speech with a dramatic challenge. He would shake his fist into heaven and say, "If there's a God, I dare him to strike me dead in the next 10 seconds. And then he would slowly count 10, 9, 8. God-fearing people fled many times to the door just knowing that God was going to do something to him. But he concluded his little demonstration by calling out and saying, "Now, how can anybody believe in God?" In one small town in Midwest, a godly woman laughed out loud at Mr. Ingersoll as he began to count. And she exclaimed, "Do you think, Mr. Ingersoll, that you can exhaust God's wonderful patience in just 10 seconds?" Ingersoll later died at the age of 65. He met his maker. He met the God that was so patient with him as he is with you and I. And God is still a patient God. Not only is God in control of all things and owns all things, but he is patient and God is love. In the parable, you'll notice that they killed the servants, they stoned the servants, they slew them. And it says he sent many more after the first. I don't know how many total they disrespected, but in life, in history, God sent hundreds of prophets to Israel, and they disrespected them and ignored the message they had. You and I need to realize that God is a God of love. Never forget the most important scripture in the Bible, John 3:16. "For God so loved the world." And I'd like for you just in your mind right now to take that term, the world, and replace it with your name. God so loved Tracy Sims that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but shall have everlasting life. God is a God of love. He's continued to wait on some of you a long time to come around, to give him the knowledge, the acknowledgement that he is in control and deserves and is worthy of your respect and your service to him. He wants you to acknowledge his ownership and to have a loving relationship with you. We need to be people who acknowledge God's power, his authority. We need to give him the love and the respect that is due him. What's so amazing about God's love is that I am a sinner by nature. You are a sinner by nature. You may think you're a pretty good guy, but I want you to understand you're a sinner. When you look at women, or when you think the wrong kind of things, when you're angry, you come out and speak vilely, and use, some of you take God's name in vain. I want you to know, by nature, we are all sinners. Some of us, it's even sinful the way we eat. My grandchildren reminded me of that last night. But you're a sinner by nature, and if not by nature, by choice. Sometimes you know that the things that you are doing are not pleasing to God, and yet you do them anyway. In the church today, the church suffers because, folks, the scriptures tell us that a little leaven leavens a whole lump. A little bit of yeast travels through that whole mixture of dough. And in the church today, because of our unholiness and our unrighteousness, I want you to know that Satan gets a foothold in our church. And the reason people aren't saved and aren't baptized many times is because, not because the preacher is failing in presenting the word, but many times people aren't saved and they aren't changed because in the church itself, the Spirit of God doesn't have liberty because we have stopped his working and his actions by simply our choices that we make. How can you and I resist the kind of love that God has shown us? In the early 60s, Time magazine was worried about their subscription rate, and IBM was in the business of trying to build what was known as some of the first computers. And so they geared up with Time magazine to build them a system that would write the letters, that would put them in an envelope, would close the envelope, and would mail it to individuals looking for more subscriptions for the magazine. But as in all computers and things, there was a glitch. One poor rancher in Wyoming received 12,634 letters appealing to him to subscribe. After reading a half a dozen of the letters or so, he sent in his $6 and asked for a subscription to the magazine with a note that says, "I give up." God's love is like that. It's continuous. God continues to work on us and to send us pictures of his love and messages of his love. And I want you to understand this. If you don't understand anything else I say today, God loves you. And he does not want to see you spend an eternity in hell. Amen. He does not want to see you spend eternity in hell. And he's not going to send you to hell. You're on your way to hell already. For those who have not believed in him are already headed to hell. Amen. So I want you to understand Jesus Christ came as a rescue for you in order that you might be saved. He is a loving, very loving God, but he is also a God who is just. He is a God who is just. After telling the story in verse 40, Jesus asked him the question, "What will the landowner do with those tenants?" And they proudly stuck out their chests, being instruments, they thought, of righteousness and holiness. The Pharisees thought a lot of their values, and they said, "He will destroy them and get tenants that will pay what they owe." Well, you know the rest of the story. Within 40 years from that time, Jerusalem was destroyed, the temple was destroyed, and the life that those men knew was no longer the same. I want you to understand, God is God of love. He loves you greatly. He loves me greatly. But he is just, and he will not compromise his justice, his righteousness for you and I. We must realize that we must be forgiven. And the forgiveness is found in the shedding blood of Jesus Christ. What is the lesson for us? The lesson is this. If I reject the gift of God's Son, I will fall under his judgment. If I reject the love of God and the gift of his Son, I will fall under his judgment. As he concluded that story, he asked them, if they have never read about the scriptures in Psalms 118, verse 22, it talks about the stone which the builders rejected had become the capstone. Now, in your translations, your Bible translations, it refers to the cornerstone in the King James and the NASB. In the NIV, and I believe in the Living Word, it refers to the capstone. Jesus was both the cornerstone and the capstone. The cornerstone is that first stone that they start out with when they're in the building project, they set the groundwork, they set that stone, and everything is squared up and built off the placement of that stone. Jesus Christ is the foundation for eternal life. Jesus is our foundation for eternal life. And everything is built on top of him. The church is built on top of him. But the capstone is that last rock that they put in that is supporting. Usually it's referred to as a keystone in archways. You know, an arch, as they build an arch in brick and masonry work, it's not self-supporting. They have to support it with different structures until they get the last rock in place, that center stone. And once that center stone is set, then it provides enough pressure against the other bricks and against the walls that it stays in place. Jesus Christ is that capstone in your and mine life. Now, Jewish tradition says this. This is not scriptural, but this is Jewish tradition. That in the building of the temple, which required 30,000 men in 7 years for Solomon to accomplish it, that there was a stone delivered to the work site. Everything was managed and built off-site, so there was not the sound of a hammer up on that holy hill where the temple was built. But they delivered those stones, rolling them on wood and posts, delivering them to the website, the land site. The general construction supervisor had saw the particular rock. It was neither square, it was not plumb with anything, it was very oddly shaped, and he took that rock and he had his men discard it over the hill, and it fell down in the valley of Kidron, which is a garbage heap. As it neared completion, he sent to the masonry department where they were cutting the stones, and he asked them, where is the last stone? Where's the keystone, the capstone for this project? And he told the general manager of the job, he said, I delivered that years ago. After searching for it for some time, they found the rock covered with trash and debris in the bottom of the garbage heap, and they brought it in and set it in place, and it fit perfectly. I want you to understand that keystone, that capstone, is Jesus Christ in your life. He's the perfect fit for what you need. You may not think so. You may not think at all times, may wonder what Jesus is doing in your life. Sometimes there's tribulation, there's trials, and things we don't understand. But he is the perfect capstone for your life. Today, I want to ask you this. Will you give him, will you find him worthy of being put into your life, being supportive of your life? Would you find him worthy of being something that you can build on and complete your life? Jesus Christ is the capstone. Without Jesus, I want you to understand this. You face an eternity in hell. And you may think that's a mild thing. I want to assure you, you don't want to go to hell. I've heard people say, well, I'll see all my friends there. In hell, you have no friends. In hell, you're alone. In hell, you're suffering torment for eternity. There are no friends in hell. There is no celebration. There is no good times. Hell is not a place you want to be. Jesus Christ is the solution to that problem. I encourage you to receive Christ as your personal Savior. Some of you have been putting off a relationship with Christ a long time. One day your time's going to run out. Even for these young men, these teenagers here, I want you to understand. One day the occasion, the opportunity runs out, and you no longer will be able to accept Christ as your Savior. Whether it comes by death, whether it comes by the return of Christ, opportunities run away. Consider that today as you consider, is Jesus worthy to be your Lord and Savior? Stand with me as we have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for your goodness to us and your mercy. Father, I thank you that Jesus is a capstone of our life. I thank you, Father, for the opportunity today to honor and to glorify him, to worship him. And Father, I pray for those that have not ever accepted him. Would you show them, would you turn on that light switch in their life and show them their great need? Would you do that for them today? I pray now that you forgive us where we sin and direct our lives. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.